Another thing causing massive growth in the West is people moving from the East. And a lot of people moving from the East are actually foreign-born. They were born in places like Scandinavia, Germany, Ireland, Russia, Czechoslovakia. They came to America on the East Coast and then moved west when they heard about the mining opportunities and farming and ranching in the West. Over 2 million foreign-born Americans will move from the East to the West in the period 1870 to 1900. Of course, this had become very easy because of the Transcontinental Railroad and the Homestead Act. You could get these 160-acre plots that the Homestead Act originally called for turned out to be too small to really support a lot of families in some parts of the country, and so they were expanded on. The Timber Culture Act of 1873 gave you another 160 acres if you planted 40 acres of trees on your land. The Desert Land Act of 1877 gave you a chance to buy up to 640 acres at $1.25 an acre if you irrigated your land. So the government is paying people to improve the land, which is one of the reasons this massive government program is one of the reasons why the West, even today, is so economically successful. If you took advantage of all the laws related to the Homestead Act, you could get 1,208 acres for one person, essentially free from the government. So really, it's government programs that lead to the expansion, growth, and ultimately economic success of the West. Territorial governments are established in Nevada, Colorado, the Dakotas, Arizona, Idaho, Montana, and Wyoming. And then they begin to demand statehood as they grow in population. Nevada, it becomes a state in 1864, Nebraska, 67, Colorado, 76, North Dakota, South Dakota, Montana, and Washington in 89, Wyoming and Idaho in 1900. But Utah is the interesting story. Utah actually had a larger population than most of these states way earlier, but it was forced to wait because Americans were uncomfortable admitting a state that allowed polygamy. But the prophet in Utah at the time, the leader of the Mormon church, had a revelation that said, okay, polygamy is not good, and the Mormon church denounced polygamy as sinful, and then eventually the Mormons were allowed to come in and become a state. Only Arizona, New Mexico, and Oklahoma are not states by 1901, and of course they'll be added not too long after that. Migration to the West will transform the region completely and tie it economically to the East. Ranchers, miners, and farmers, they need labor. The thing about the West is there's tons of land, there's tons of resources, there's just not much labor, there's little to be found locally. And so they're forced to pay high wages to find people to come. But the jobs are unstable. And so you get all kinds of people coming in to take advantage of these of the high pay rates. And it creates a highly multiracial, multilingual society. Because if you're a farmer and you don't have enough people to work your land, you can't turn away somebody because they're black or because they're Mexican and they don't speak English. You need workers. And so what you have is all kinds of different races, all kinds of different cultures working side by side in the West. But the whites were the management class. They were the skilled labor. They were the owners. And non-whites were the unskilled labor of the West. So it still was class divided by race. But it wasn't completely segregated by race, like we'll see in many situations in the East. Between the 1860s and the 90s, mining is going to boom in the West, which means it's going to be really successful. And then it's going to decline sharply. What will happen is somebody will find a precious metal somewhere, and hundreds or thousands of people will converge to try to get as much of it as possible. And then one day, they won't be able to find anymore, and everybody will leave just as quick as they came. It's really a remarkable story. We call this a boom town. And this is going to be an area that is nothing, that's literally nobody there, no structures, nothing. Somebody finds a piece of gold or lead or zinc or molybdenum or silver or whatever it is. And then they go and they sell it, and everybody tries to figure out where they got it from. And within a week or a month or so, there might be 1,000 people trying to live there with zero infrastructure to start with. It's really pretty amazing. At first, you have surface mining, and these are people who are actually picking it up off the ground or maybe finding it in riverbeds. And eventually, it's going to evolve into large-scale professional mining operations that are digging mine shafts with the carts and all that stuff. After the load is exhausted, after everything is mined out, then it will become a farming community, those who stay. But the population will almost certainly shrink to almost nothing. In 1858, when gold is found on Pikes Peak in Colorado, 50,000 people come there in 1 year. It goes from a population of 0 to 50,000 in 12 months. Imagine all the homes, the stores, the saloons, the roads, everything that has to be built to accommodate a city of 50,000 people, and they have to do that in 12 months. in Leadville. There's a great silver strike, Leadville, which is one of the biggest silver deposits in history. Gold is found in the Washoe District of Nevada. The Comstock Lode, a massive silver strike. Most of these miners come from California. They were gold rush people who end up just following the strikes around. Companies, if you're a prospector and you find gold, if you own land that has gold on it, companies are probably going to come in and try to buy that from you. And you probably want to sell it because you probably don't have the ability to set up a large-scale mining operation. The companies, of course, would come in, mine everything of value, get rich, and leave. Between 1860 and 1880, Nevada yielded $306 million in precious metals, and then nothing. It was all gone. It had mined up. In 1874, gold is found in the Black Hills of South Dakota. And if you want to see a brilliant depiction of a mining town, there's an HBO series called Deadwood. If you're under 18, ask your parents because it has about as much cussing as anything ever made. But it is an incredible display of what a mining town is like. It's not all about gold and silver either, we should understand that. The Anaconda Copper Mine in 1881 in Montana made many people rich. Lead, tin, quartz, zinc, molybdenum, which I mentioned earlier, are also profitable strikes. But let's imagine for a minute what these places are like. We're talking a place where everybody is there as a worker who just showed up because they needed to make money. This is going to attract young men, and young men who aren't established in any way, young men who don't have strong personal family connections, young men who aren't married almost certainly. This is going to attract the most unstable elements of society. There are few women there. Some of the women there are going to be wives because they did occasionally bring their wives with them. But almost all the single women are probably prostitutes. And this is why these places are going to be so violent and out of control. You also have these people who have nothing, and then one day they find precious metals, and they get rich overnight. And, of course, they go into town, they start throwing their money around. All these other people who haven't found metal now have a big incentive to try to rob that person. This is the Wild West. The Wild West was not really the cowboys. It wasn't the ranches. It was the boom towns. This is where Wild Bill Hickok was shot. For his being suspected of cheating at poker. That happened in Deadwood. This is the Wild West, not so much the cowboys. Most, of course, who came to mining towns, they never find wealth. They end up being laborers working for somebody else. It was a dangerous job. In the 1870s, one out of every mine workers is killed working in the mine. It's the most dangerous large-scale job in America.